Okay, great. So I have to admit that although the panel is female and many of the topics are very female specific in terms of gestational and menstrual and osteoporosis, today my topic of diabetes reversal would be a gender neutral topic. Although coming from the Indian context, I think one additional caveat here is that if the female in the house gets it, then many people in the house get it, in the sense of if she understands reversal, then there's a multiple benefit that happens when you educate and empower the female. So I guess that's one additional point I can say, but the two cases that I'm sharing today happen to be male patients. So bear with me for that. All right, so first of all, when we're talking about type 2 diabetes reversal, let's just be very clear that we're definitely not talking about type 1 reversal, where there is insulin deficiency. When you do the C-peptide test, you see of C-peptide, which confirms that there is a deficiency of insulin production. That's not the type of diabetes we're talking about today. We're talking about type 2, which is insulin resistance. And in the way to know what's happening is to check the C-peptide. So really, before I talk about reversal with any of my patients, I talk about getting the fasting C-peptide. And there's a lot of interest in the post-meal insulin response. So you can do this if you have it available, but at least getting the C-peptide so you know you're not making a mistake with a LADA, a latent autoimmune diabetes of adulthood. You need to make sure. Even this concept of burnt out type 2 is less prevalent than what we were made to believe. That's why having the C-peptide with you will help you with a lot of confidence, even in someone with longstanding diabetes. This is the concept slide of the overflow phenomenon that we've been treating diabetes as a problem of high blood sugar. And a lot of our therapy is targeted at lowering blood sugar and lowering A1C. Whereas actually the concept is more about when you're talking reversal, you have to understand to address it head on at the insulin resistance level, which is the fact that insulin is present in the body, but there is insulin resistance. And to address it there in terms of reversal, we are going to be talking in terms of nutrition, sleep, stress, exercise, and fasting. And really, I had to psych myself up that this is a very complex topic of reversal that I'm trying to give you in 15 minutes. So bear with me that I'm going a bit quick and as a very broad overview here. This is the concept slide from the Diabetes Care 2013. I highly encourage everybody to read it. Maybe all of you have already seen this, but it's about the twin vicious cycles going on in the liver and the pancreas, and where there is pre-existing muscle insulin resistance, increased fatty liver, okay, suppression of resistance to insulin mediated suppression of hepatic gluconeogenesis, which is where we see the early fasting sugars, and elevated basal insulin secretion. Again, we're dealing with high insulin levels, not deficient insulin levels. Of course, that shows up as hyperglycemia. And at the pancreatic level, you have pancreatic fat, pancreatic triglyceride, and a weak or a deficient response to the meals. And therefore, you see the postprandial sugar. So that's the vicious cycle that we will be addressing through lifestyle. But this is a beautiful description of it. And of course, at the background, this color green will keep coming up through the next 10 minutes, is the family tendency will remain. I myself have a genetic tendency, Gujarati family tree. I've hit pre-diabetes myself when I went through a very stressful patch in my life. Passed all my gestational, there's a gestational talk today. Both of my OGTs and both my pregnancies were perfectly normal. I've had healthy pregnancies with no diabetes whatsoever, but it came much later once I was going through a stress patch. But through lifestyle change, I've reversed it, although my family tree is exactly the same. So if I had to really simplify what we look at in terms of how, what are the modifiable things you can do in insulin resistance with your patient to reverse type 2 diabetes at a lifestyle level, in the carbs, you're looking for, in nutrition, you're looking for carbohydrate predominant intake as a very big problem. Small frequent meals, and some of this comes from our prescriptions where we might have them on sulfonylureas. We might have them on things, repaglinide, which is actually in between meals causing hypoglycemia. So part of the nutrition therapy then is to eat small frequent meals to avoid hypoglycemia, which is an iatrogenic situation and the patient cannot lose weight. So that's a very difficult situation to put the patient in. We need to stop doing that. Protein deficiency, sleep, again, screen time. This could be a 1 hour talk just in itself, the relationship between screen time and deficient sleep quality with insulin resistance. And of course, being that it's a medical audience, sleep apnea, very underdiagnosed, but huge contributor. We've seen diabetes reversal happen the minute we put people on CPAP because the insulin resistance was just broken down. Stress, of course, we know hypercortisolemia is an issue. And if you saw in Ron Taylor's slide, he's mentioned there about muscle insulin resistance, which is something in India we forget about. Our Indian patients will stop the sugar in the tea the minute they find out about diabetes, and they'll put the diabetic friendly biscuits and then they'll start walking. So the walking is okay, but it's not giving you the muscle mass. You really need to, and I'm not talking about huge bodybuilding or gymming to an nth level. At any age, age appropriate safety involved with physiotherapy, strength training, even I have had 75, 76 year old people do very basic physiotherapy, and the plateau of reversal gets broken just by getting them to start using the muscles. This is my oversimplified slide. I actually spend more than an hour on this slide because the complexity is even more than the arrows that I've put here. And we know that if I have to tell somebody to do the lifestyle change, let's say you've not slept well, I tell you to exercise, you won't be able to. If you've not slept well, you're going to be more cranky. And if you're not feeling emotionally well, you might go into some emotional eating of carbs. There is no drug for this. There is no prescription medication we are trained to write. So this is where you need to be able to break it down for your patients to be able to work at the lifestyle level for reversal. So what are the solutions? Again, super fast, I'm going through at a very top level, is going low carbohydrate, getting the proteins to target. We're talking minimum of 0.8 grams per kg, minimum. If you look at the parameters, anything below that really counts as protein malnutrition. But because Indian average diet recalls that we assess, we see people taking 0.3 to 0.4. So when I tell them 0.8, they're actually balking and saying, this is a high protein diet. So you really need to educate them that even in CKD, even with proteinuria, you need a minimum of 0.8, irrespective of whether you are working out or not. It's not only for people who are doing strength training. You need 0.8 as a minimum on the eating days. If you're fasting, that's a whole different topic of your protein targets on fasting days. Get the sleep hygiene, screen time sorted, tube lights, late night screen time, treat the sleep apnea. I talk a lot about stress reduction and spirituality with my patients. So I don't think, you know, we need to be psychiatrists or therapists to be able to just even put a little bit, because we are at the top of the pyramid. If at the top of the food chain of healthcare training, if we put in that little 30 seconds, the patient actually takes note of what we mentioned, and they might take stress management seriously. Building muscle, I talked about. Again, we are not qualified to tell them what exercise, and I got stuck a lot of times here where they'll say no spondylosis, no sciatica, no hip replacement. So I went and became a personal trainer because I had so much knowledge gaps in exercise. We're not trained in exercise. Oh, yes, doctors. So that was one more thing. So let me get to a real case so I can make it a bit relevant before the next 7 minutes runs out. This was somebody, somebody I saw way back and had a long history of 15 years of diabetes, uncontrolled on 5 tablets, and had a history of tuberculosis. So everybody was like nervous that this guy needs to get his diabetes under control. And here he is, he's refusing insulin. So his care provider referred him to me saying, look, this guy's refusing insulin, send to an endocrinologist, right? So we inquired, and we told him, bring back your food diary. And this man, Gujarati fellow, I'm Gujarati, he was eating 10 chapatis per meal. Now this is an extreme case, okay? This is like a reportable number of chapatis per meal, but extremely high intake of carbs, protein deficient. And when he brought the 10 chapatis down and an A1C of 11, you know, he started to see rapidly. I saw within 2 weeks that he was able to do things like, you know, halving his chapatis and doubling up on his dal and sabji. Same menu, same kitchen, same dynamics happening in the food planning, but he was able to bring his sugars down to 94. And this is from him in 2013. This is the follow-up. This sheet here is my handwriting. You can see here, it's a scan note from Jan 2014. And this is back when I was at Hinduja, and we actually tapered him down from the 5 tablets. We kept him on his sitagliptin and metformin. And I said, look, I'll stop your Wogli bows if you agree to cut your carbs further. And this is my handwriting saying, look, I'll stop your Wogli bows if you stop eating the carbs. Why should I make you malabsorb the carbohydrates? Okay. Because you're eating them. So if you don't eat them, then the question of me forcing you to malabsorb them with Wogli bows doesn't arise. You know, it just seems really backwards the way we do it sometimes. And 16 months later, which was July 2014, he brought his A1C down. So clearly back then I wasn't doing C-peptide, but I was really scratching my head because we were trained to think that failed on 5 drugs means insulin. And here this guy's now doing better on 2 drugs. So his pancreas is clearly not burnt out. You know, this is really one of the first guys who made me rethink this concept of pancreatic burnout. And I should give you an update, actually. This is from July 2014, and this is, we're sitting in July 2020 now. And of course, before talking to you all today, I wanted to speak to him. So we contacted him. He actually just got discharged post-COVID. He was in the hospital with COVID. He recovered from his COVID. We got updates from his son today, right before these slides. And I didn't get a chance to put it because the son is not yet back home from work. But his father's diabetes is still controlled. So he has not come off of his drugs yet, but his diabetes was controlled and he's come out of COVID and come back home. So again, for me, that's really a positive story. This is someone we worked with during lockdown. He's based out of Indore. And this was 15-year history. He had an A1C, again, super high. You can see the central obesity. He was taking 70 units of glargine once a day, 50, 50, 50, 150 of bolus insulin with the three meals. We checked his C-peptide, and lo and behold, he's not type 1. He's not pancreatic burnout. He is type 2. So again, we moved him, we moved his entire treatment regimen to get him off the insulin, low carb. He's on metformin plus sitagliptin, again, same like the other guy, because I find that this is the safest way to get people to start fasting. And he's been off insulin for 3 months. His visceral obesity is going down. He thinks this is his second lease on life. He feels that this is his last chance to get his health on track. And he's like, abhi bahut enjoy kar liya. Let me take my health seriously and be around for my kids. And he does intermittent fasting. He plans to reduce weight further. I, of course, need his A1C to come down lower. This is not reversal yet. And we need to taper his drugs down further as well. So, you know, I just like to do this because I've sat through so many of these during training and I've sat through so many of these sponsored events. So I'm thankful that the sponsors call someone like me to talk about prescribing, right? Like, what about that chronic progressive graph that we keep seeing that type 2 diabetes is chronic and progressive? And how about we start flipping this around? Is that once you get a diagnosis, before you start prescribing anything, focus aggressively on the nutrition, sleep, stress, exercise, and fasting. It actually works. Going low carb, even if you're a vegetarian, in Indian context, with our phenotype, with everything that we have with our thin fat and everything we say at our meetings, this actually works in our population. And short-term drugs. I saw some questions that were sent through on the WhatsApp for the panelists, and I'll take some of those later in terms of drug choices. But this is what I start with. Only caveat being, if they have a borderline low C-peptide, I will not use a DPP-4. That's one thing I watch for, okay? And we work on the lifestyle change, and we are actually see the A1Cs come down, de-prescribing insulin if the C-peptide is present. And this is 2020. So what I'm telling you is not hokey pokey or, you know, out of the way. It's not like Roshni's left mainstream allopathy and she's talking something nonsense. This is Jan 2020 standards of care ADA document. Everybody knows about this document, but what's written in the fine print in the medical nutrition therapy section, okay, is the part I really scroll for every time. This is Jan 2020 PDF and it's in fine print here. It's quite a tricky language, but I'll read it to you because y'all are able to understand this, is for individuals with type 2 not meeting glycemic targets or for whom reducing glucose-lowering drugs is a priority. Means in plain and simple language, is saying that if your patient has a priority to be on less medication, which of our patients wants to be on more medication? When you look at the treatment algorithm tree, it says if established CVD, if CKD, if heart failure, go here. If you want to avoid hypoglycemia, you go here. If you want to avoid weight gain, you go here. If you want to avoid, what's the third one? Hypoglycemia, weight gain, and cost. Okay, so if you want to avoid these, you go in that algorithm. But nowhere in the algorithm does it give you the option to think about, well, is reducing the medication burden a priority? But here it is in the document in the back section. If the priority is to reduce drugs, then reducing overall carb intake with low or very low carb is a viable option, and there are papers to back it up. All right, so they've mentioned this clearly in the medical nutrition therapy section. What they haven't mentioned yet is intermittent fasting. I'm waiting for that. Maybe it'll come as time-restricted eating in one of the next ADA updates, okay? But it's there for you to do it. You will not be doing something which is not evidence-based. It's completely scientific. So this is the way I talk about it with my patients, is that we need to help you navigate life through lifestyle change. And there will be ups and downs. Things will happen, weddings, deaths, coronavirus. Through that, how do you manage? So you need to give the confidence to your patients. So this is my last slide and I have to finish in 30 seconds. So these would be the points to cover in terms of using lifestyle change to reverse diabetes. It happens, it actually happens in the Indian context as well. So thank you very much. I don't want to step over onto the next speaker. Thank you.